Miss Saigon premiered at the Theatre Royal, Drury Lane, in London on September 20th, 1989, and moved to the Broadway Theatre in New York on April 11th, 1991. The creators of Miss Saigon were French, the producer and director British, the choreographer, co-lyricist, and subject matter American, and the cast was Asian, or at least strived to be. The musical was produced by Cameron McIntosh, who also produced hits like Cats, Les Miserables, and The Phantom of the Opera. Based on Puccini's opera, Madame Butterfly, the book was written by Claude-Michel Schoenberg and Alain Boublil, with music by Schoenberg and lyrics by Richard Maltby Jr. and Boublil. Both London and Broadway productions were directed by Nicholas Heitner and stage choreographed by Bob Avian. The production became the sixth longest running show on Broadway when it finally closed after 4,092 performances on January 28, 2001, but it is currently the 10th longest running Broadway show. It had grossed more than $266 million and had been seen by 6 million people. With a contemporary setting in Saigon and Bangkok, Boublil and Schoenberg wrote a modern musical tragedy with seriousness and integrity that has a strong topical and political significance and heartbreaking emotion. Miss Saigon has also achieved a universal audience, and millions of people all over the world have taken it to heart. Miss Saigon has been opened by 26 companies and has been played in 23 countries and translated in 11 different languages, including Japanese, German, Hungarian, Danish, Estonian, and Czech. Miss Saigon was inspired by a news photograph showing a Vietnamese woman parting her child at Tan Son Nhut Airport so that the child could have a better life with her GI father in the United States. Schoenberg said, "I had been having a coffee break one autumn afternoon in Paris when this photograph in a magazine caught my eye. The woman, stunned by her grief and the child's tears, were the final condemnation of all wars, which shatter people who leave each other. It was the most moving, the most staggering example of the ultimate sacrifice, just as you have in Madame Butterfly. But Miss Saigon is not a history of the Vietnam War. It's a story of two people lost in the middle of the war." In Miss Saigon, Chris meets an innocent bar girl, Kim, at Dreamland, a bar for American GIs run by the scheming engineer, who wants to live a better life in America. After falling in love with each other that night, Chris and Kim marry. However, their celebrations are interrupted when Tui arrives, because Kim's father had arranged her and Tui to marry. Saigon is about to fall, and Chris must return to America, leaving Kim behind. However, unbeknownst to Chris, Kim gives birth to his child, Tam. Upon realizing this, the engineer plans to use Tam as his American visa so he can finally leave to America, posing as Tam's uncle. 3 years have passed, and Chris has a new American wife. Because Chris's new wife, Ellen, refuses to take a child from his mother, Kim realizes that she is the only obstacle preventing Tam to have a better future. The technomusical evoked no thoughts of the past. It provoked little or no thinking at all. Spectacle would triumph over substance, and writers of musical theater, devoid of real ideas, and perhaps taking their cue from the revolution in telecommunications, turned to spectacle to attract audiences. Broadway shows owed their longevity largely to awestruck viewers oohing and awing at elaborate and seemingly miraculous technical effects. The term technomusical is a show that relies heavily upon theater technology rather than real content. In technomusicals, it's spectacle, not substance, that brings in the bucks. Look at the top 10 longest-running Broadway shows: The Phantom of the Opera, Cats, Les Miserables, Beauty and the Beast, The Lion King, and Miss Saigon are all musicals that value spectacle over substance, heavily relying on commercialism, technical achievements, or both. Audiences come to see Cats for the makeup and pussycat suits, Phantom for the falling chandelier, Beauty and the Beast for the costumes, The Lion King for Julie Taymor's masterful costume and puppetry designing, and Miss Saigon for designer John Napier's helicopter. Napier designed a number of splendid scenic elements for Miss Saigon. Its enormous Ho Chi Minh statues, the Cadillac centerpiece of the American Dream sequence, and the landing of the chopper, a triumph of theater technology and the key drawing card for audiences, that make Miss Saigon a technomusical. However, when the production transferred to New York's Broadway Theater, some aspects of the set had to be adjusted. The Ho Chi Minh statue had to be scaled down to 20 feet and 800 pounds, and a smaller version of the American Dream Cadillac had to be especially built in place of the real Cadillac in the London show. The production cost $10 million, which was expensive for a show back in 1991. Even though Miss Saigon has a strong plot and strong characters like Puccini's Madame Butterfly, it's not the story, musical score, or performances that attract audiences. It's the goddamn helicopter. The most common image people think of when they envision Miss Saigon is the helicopter, and that is also the most common reason why people will see the show, to see the helicopter. Even though the creators of Miss Saigon intended for the show to be about the consequences of America in Vietnam, the helicopter rose to higher prominence and became the essential moment of the show, in the public's eyes. Producer Cameron McIntosh wanted audiences to see the show not only because of the story, but because of the helicopter, which is why he implemented the image on the Miss Saigon logo. McIntosh productions are well known because they are highly publicized with the logo, a marketing tool, his musical posters are iconic, and the most widely recognizable throughout the world.
And we went backwards and forwards and for months developing it. I think it's the longest one we've ever had. This was the 1920s version. No, Miss Butterfly. That is going to turn up at a restaurant around the corner. No, this was the 1920s one, wasn't it? Yes. World of Woozy Song.
Yeah, I mean, we were very much sort of conditioned by the fact that it was a Madame Butterfly story originally. That's why this sort of
and then
developed.
The idea of the sun came in, which we kept, and the moonlight was to make it romantic. Gosh, this was when we were going to do it in America first, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But it took it too near Madame Butterfly, whereas actually Madame Butterfly is just the jumping off ground for what Alain and Claude Michel have written. But then Russ did masses of scribbles,
which were
part of the helicopter.
Mm-hmm.
And it started to become there a hieroglyphic. Oh, that was the same time we were working on the background. That was the time when the graphic sort of moved into the sun, and I wanted to get a woman's face into it. We felt it was a good idea, and this was an attempt here.
Mm-hmm.
Russ had the brilliant idea of putting a face into the slipstream. It was the only place that you could hide it, and you wouldn't see it, and then once you saw it, you'd always see it.
Can you see a woman's face in the logo?